Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Q1 FY22 earnings conference call of Philatex India Limited, hosted by Motilal Oswal Financial Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on a touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Suman Kumar from Motilal Oswal Financial Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, everyone. Good afternoon, everyone, and a very warm welcome to Philatex India Limited Q1 FY22 post-result earning call hosted by Motilal Oswal Financial Services. On the call today, we have management team being represented by Mr. Madhu Sudan Bhagiria, Chairman and Managing Director, Mr. Madhav Bhagiria, Joint MD and CEO, CFO, Mr. Ashok Chauhan, Executive Director, and Ms. Stuti Bhagiria, Senior VP, Corporate Strategy. We'll begin the call with key thoughts from the management team. Thereafter, we will open the floor for Q&A session. I would now like to request the management to share their perspective on the performance of the company. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sumit. Myself, Madhu Sudan Bhagiria. Good afternoon to all. Once again, a warm welcome to all of you attending this earning call for the quarter ended June 2021. I hope all of you have safely sailed through the havoc caused by the second wave of COVID, which has affected millions of lives. I presume you would have certainly have gone through the presentation, which has been uploaded on our website as well as on the stock exchanges. The textile industry, after a very tough period from April to July in 2020, enjoyed a breather from the upheavals of slowdown, shutdown, corona, labor shortage, container shortage, high shipping costs, etc., etc. In fact, the performance in fourth quarter last year was the best till date, and this would be true for almost all companies in textile sector. The recovery was not just for synthetic yarn, but for the cotton and other blends. Increase in duty rates on cheap imports had a curbing effect, which also contributed to the in the market. Export market opportunities came in plenty, but could not materialize fully due to very erratic shipping schedules and rather steep shipping costs. We had expected the momentum to continue in the first quarter, but it started going down as the number of COVID cases increased rapidly. In the last phone call, we had expressed exuberance in the market in Q3, which continued almost through the next quarter. We had said that if Q3 was extraordinary, then Q4 was stupendous. However, we also mentioned that it was rather exceptional and unlikely to continue as a benchmark for any comparison. The first quarter of FY22 has been a mixed bag. As the second wave of COVID hit the country, let me quickly go through the results of this quarter, Q1 FY22, before talking about the second wave. We achieved a production volume of 78,000 metric tons, which is around 81% of our capacity. The revenue for the quarter is 699 crores, and operating profit EBITDA is around 101 crores. Profit before tax is 76 crores and net profit PAT 52 crores. We have not compared the results on Q-on-Q basis for Q1 of last year as the comparative conditions are vastly different and it would not make much sense. To understand the economic impact of the second wave, let's revisit and remind ourselves of the first wave and its impact on the economy. In the first wave, we went through a prolonged national lockdown and a significantly lower number of peak cases. manufacturing and the urban economy had come to a grinding halt, while the rural economy continued to move because of less strict lockdown. As a result, agriculture, which is primary driver of our rural economy, providing employment to 58% of our population, continued to grow. Agriculture further benefited from good monsoon and cheaper and higher availability of labor. Reflecting on the GDP figures, our agriculture economy grew by 3.4%, while the overall economy contracted with 7.7% in FY21. The first wave was primarily urban in its spread. So when partial relaxation was announced, manufacturing activities at partial capacity started rolling up. Gradually, as the migrant labor returned, the capacity utilization rates went up. In fact, by the end of whole financial year, almost all manufacturing sectors did well. The joy of spendthrift recovery in Q4 last year was short-lived. The sign of second wave was visible. However, the mood across the country was that we have managed to bear and now contain the virus. The visible signs were not taken seriously. No travel ban and laxity in testing. Comfort of first shot of vaccine gave us a false sense of security. The COVID patients number started rising exponentially, and no one knew what to do and how to treat the infected person. There is hardly a family which did not have a case. The second wave was more devastating in its effect, causing extreme stress on healthcare infrastructure. As in the second wave, rural areas started reporting more cases than urban ones. The distress and panic was widespread. Analysis of more than 50 most severely hit districts indicated that 26 were in rural areas. The situation was further aggravated due to the inadequacy of medical infrastructure in the rural areas and the rush of patients from villages and smaller towns to urban centers. We believe that economic fallout of the second wave of the pandemic at worst is likely to remain restricted to the first half of this financial year. Although availability of vaccines and revival in private consumption will determine the speed of economic recovery. Although some contact intensive sectors like hospitality, leisure travel may continue to be hit harder than the rest of the economy. The economic damage from the second wave is likely to remain restricted. We also expect the overall hit to India's economy to be softer than that during the first wave last year. As the lockdowns have been localized and city or state specific, consumption was stalled, but manufacturing activities were allowed to continue. So there was little loss of production. However, the pace of economic recovery will be determined by access to and delivery of vaccines and the strength of recovery in private consumption, which could be hampered by the slump of income streams of low and middle income households from job and wealth losses. Besides increasing healthcare infrastructure spend, it is crucial for the government to extend employment and income support to smaller firms, the rural economy, including unorganized sector, the services sector, and the urban poor, the four segments most likely affected by the reimposition and extension of restrictions. Steep rise in medical expenses, along with dwindling income, has also added to the pain. The textile sector as a whole is quite self-reliant in terms of raw materials, skill sets, manpower, and not to forget a well-established domestic market. Several experts and advisors had identified stagnating factors such as lack of skills, bias towards cotton, inadequate support to MSMEs, preferential trade agreements, etc. The government's blueprint enumerating policy initiatives has started addressing all these issues as Atmanirbhar vision moves on to implementation stage. The government has recognized the importance of textile sector in job creation and importance of man-made fibers in textile fiber baskets. we continue to remain bullish about our prospects. The Indian polyester industry, after removal of anti-dumping duty on key raw material, that is PTA, has improved its competitiveness and capacity utilization has improved. There are some other structural anomalies like inverted GST structure, which are hampering the growth. Polyester industry continues to suffer on account of inverted GST structure, higher rate of 18% on raw material and 12% on finished products like yarn, and going forward in the value chain, 5% on fabrics and garments. A uniform GST rate across the whole chain will ease the working capital needs and spur growth across the whole industry, which has many MSME companies as the end users. The policies are being reviewed and modified to remove the roadblocks for accelerated growth in fabric and garments made from MMF. The government has taken effective steps to plug loopholes by imposing value addition norms on garments, which have curbed the duty-free imports from FTA countries. Custom duty rates have been increased from 10 to 20% on import of around 300 textile products. The government has extended the rebate of state and central taxes and levies, ROSCTL, for exports of apparel, garments and made-ups till March 2024. However, textile products which are not covered under ROSCTL would be eligible to avail the benefits under RODTEP. This will be a big boost to exports, including textile products. Another boost is inclusion of MMF garments and apparels in PLI scheme. Anti-China sentiments are gaining ground in global trade, and these schemes are likely to boost exports, which are currently hampered due to high shipping rates as well as high number of COVID cases worldwide. Load trial of 30 megawatt captive power plant at Dahej is going on since last 2 weeks. We are aiming to achieve commercial operations of the power plant shortly. The erection and commissioning was hampered severely by travel restrictions of experts from Pune, Maharashtra, and spread of COVID, which led to suspension of work. Almost the whole erection team of boilers suppliers had to be quarantined due to COVID. Upon completion of this captive power plant, the annual impact of savings in energy costs will be around rupees 40 crores. The company continues to review its plant operations and equipment and their optimal utilization. This exercise helps us optimize operating costs as well as opportunities for debottlenecking any surplus capacity. The company has identified opportunities to increase its CP melt capacity by around 50 tons per day. This additional melt, along with surplus chips volume, will be utilized for producing around 120 metric tons per day of POI. In my last conference call for Q4 FY21, I had explained our rationale about chemical recycling. Our company is again engaged in R&D activities, developing process parameters for recycling of polyesters. The future of textile manufacturing is at an inflection point. Global production of textile and apparels has rapidly increased over the last decade, which has led to generation of large amount of textile waste. Polyester, owing to its affordability and versatility, is the preferred and most dominant fiber. To ensure sustainability and reduce environment impacts in the textile and apparel industry, utilizing a sustainable and circular economy model is of utmost importance. The industry requires manufacturers to set up its efforts for meeting sustainable environmental standards. Initial efforts on recycling were limited to PET bottles being washed, cleaned, and reprocessed into fibers. Another possible alternative is by way of chemical recycling, in which all kind of PET waste, be it bottles or textile waste, is depolymerized in a controlled manner, which after purification is repolymerized to produce PET products, matching in quality to that produced by virgin raw materials. After successful lab trials, now we are moving ahead with 1,000 kgs per day pilot plant, which help us revalidate our process conditions and operating costs. With the growing textile and apparel markets of India improving exports competitiveness, there are significant opportunities across all fiber types and products. Our MMF-based textile products are expected to be leading in demand globally. India's MMF-based textile manufacturing is focused towards low value-added and commodity products. The demand for high value-added products like sportswear, performance wear, and athleisure is growing rapidly worldwide. Countries like Taiwan, Korea, and China are already into manufacturing high-end MMF-based textiles. To keep pace with current trends and needs, Indian economy needs to invest and develop capabilities, MMF textiles and apparel products to tap the higher value-added segment. Thank you all for listening to our assessment of the current economic scenario and continued belief in bright prospects of polyester textile industry. I now will gladly respond to all the questions that you may like to ask. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Ravi Sundaram from Sundaram Family Investment. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, team. Thanks for the opportunity. I have two questions. Sir, my first question is, how has been the demand as you see as we are progressing into Q2 and the realizations for yarn? I don't have to give them in the number, but the trend.
Yeah, going forward in Q2, the demand has started picking up. And I feel that by the end of Q2, we should be having demand as we had in last year in Q3. And as per the margins also, right now margins are under pressure, but they have shown signs of improvement. And I think as the demand increases, the margins will also increase going forward.
Okay. I had one question on margins. I noticed that PTA prices, which is one of your key raw materials, have actually gone up. I assume MEG prices also have gone up. Will this have any impact in your upcoming quarters or Q2 to start with?
Upcoming quarter depends. If there's the demand increases, we will be able to pass it on. But in this Q1, we were not able to pass it on fully because the demand was low and it was going down. But from beginning of July, the demand has started showing signs of improvement. And as the demand increases, we will be able to pass on whatever increases there, and maybe more than that.
Okay. One last question. This is on accounting entry side. So what is the depreciation number that would hit the quarterly numbers when we have the new power plant coming in? I understand we will have yearly 40 crores saving in power cost.
I couldn't get your question, please.
Once we have the new power plant commissioned, what will be the depreciation number that will be added due to the new asset?
Depreciation, I think on a quarterly basis, it will add to maybe on an annual basis, it will add around 4 to 4.5 crores more.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much, sir. That's all. Have a great day.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vivek Chulralia, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. So in the last call that you mentioned that we did a bit talk about 120 crores in Q3. And you said going forward, you should be able to maintain that a bit more and then the power cost savings on that. I mean, Q1 has been a bit weak, but are we still on track to deliver those kind of numbers, or do you think there might be a lag of one or two quarters?
Already there's a lag of one quarter, and the second quarter I also don't expect to reach that level. But from third quarter onwards, yeah, we expect to do what I have said or maybe better than that. Because now the demand has started picking up. And as it picks going forward, it picks up, the margins will improve and we will be able to achieve what I have said, maybe better. And this is based on the facts, seeing the international margins. So internationally, the margins which are there, we have based our calculations on that, and that too on a little lower side.
So one more question, sir. I was just going through the numbers over the past 5, 7, 8 years. We've done a margin band of 8 to 10%, and after COVID, that has obviously almost doubled to 16, 17. I just wanted to understand, do you think it's a 1-2 year sort of a scenario where we're able to utilize maybe a tightened market in terms of supply, or do you think there's some structural change in which over the next 3-4 years you feel confident that we'll be able to maintain the sort of numbers that we are showing at the moment? I just wanted to get a broad picture of next 2-3 years.
Yeah, there has been structural change, and there are a lot of factors which are contributing to this. One, I said, is the anti-dumping duty removed on our raw material has helped us in improving the margins. Also, the demand has also grown locally, and there has been no capacity additions in the industry for last 1.5 years. Rather, there was a fire in February 20, which destroyed almost like 6-7% of the capacity. And also, the government has put some curbs on imports, which were coming at a very zero duty or a lower duty. So all those factors have helped us, and in the long run will help us in keeping the margin at these levels.
Okay, so just one more question. In one of the media interviews today, you said that you hope to achieve a top line of about 30 to 100 crores this year. I was just wanting to get a sense, over the next 2-3 years, can we do a 10-15% CAGR on the top line, or I mean, I'm just trying to understand for FY23, can we expect an increase in the volumes and the top line figure over FY22?
It's difficult to say on the top line, because top line is also governed by the raw material prices in our case.
Yeah.
We expect to do around 3,200 this year on the current raw material prices. And next year we should add, because we are adding certain new capacity of POI. So we should be able to add at least 12-15% next year. And then going forward also, once we do more expansion or more value addition things, we should be able to add. But the top line would be dependent on the raw material.
On the raw material.
Definitely profitability we will be able to improve year on year.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank
you. Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rushabh Shah from RS Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah.
So I just want to, there was some news article, yesterday that Europe has, suspended some GSP status of Pakistan. So is this true, and does the company anyway benefit, or some opportunity can arise for us?
I think that status is yet to be suspended. There are talks about suspension. And once it is suspended, I think the whole textile industry can get some benefits, and then indirectly we will also get benefits because of the demand of textile products increasing in Europe from India.
So how does Philatech stand to benefit? Is it a game changer, possible game changer if it happens?
No, I can't say right now, because the demand for the fabrics and garments will be more there. The demand for yarn is not too much, and Pakistan was not exporting too much yarn to Europe. So I don't see yarn directly getting impacted by this.
Okay. And so we have seen a change in the textile ministry sometime back. So is there any talks of the new national textile policy which is yet to be announced? Are you seeing any kind of benefit that we can get from that?
I think the PLI scheme which they will be announcing very shortly, I think maybe after the parliament session. So there they have included a lot of garments of man-made and fabrics of man-made in the PLI scheme. So that will give a boost to us because the demand for the man-made yarns and fibers would increase. So that is one big announcement which is to be coming. And then also after the session, there is a GST Council meeting scheduled that we expect if they rationalize our GST rates, that also will be a boost for us.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Deepesh Kayal, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Congratulations on the results. I think we have done commendably. And looking at the financials, I was just concerned on the change in inventory front. So I think we have, constantly been decreasing our inventory. Any strategical move on that front or any light on that?
Change in what did you say?
Change in inventory of finished goods, work in progress.
Yeah, finished good inventory has increased because we didn't reduce the production as per the demand. So inventory is higher because the raw material prices were firming up and we didn't want it to lose out on the production. So at the moment, the finished good inventory is on a higher side. But we hope to liquidate in this quarter and next quarter as the demand increases.
So you said, are we piling up? Because I think the change in inventory shows a negative figure. So I think we are realizing on our inventory.
So negative shows that we have increased the inventory.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Because that's on the expense side, no? Expense side, negative shows there's an increase in the inventory.
Okay.
It gets reduced from the expenses because it's an inventory. It's not expenditure.
Got your point.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants to ask a question, please press star and one now. The next question is from the line of Sudhir Bheda from Right Time Consultant Services. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir, and congratulations on good set of numbers given the challenging circumstances.
Thank you.
Your team and you did a really commendable job. Sir, my question is, we have produced around 83,900, so almost 84,000 metric ton in March quarter. But we understand that given the circumstances, we have produced around 67,000. Out of that, 5,000 was chips and 62,000 were yarn. So going forward in the coming quarters, when do you expect to reach at this 84,000 level? So
I think in Q3 we will be able to reach that level. For sure.
Oh, great. And see, if you look at the margin, there is a 22% margin was there in Q4, which was of course it was exceptionally high margin. And then we have around 14.45% in this June quarter. So how do you see margin going forward after the commencement of power plant? And also we are going for value-added product. So how do you see this margin panning out in the rest of the year?
I think on an average, we should be doing in the whole year around 14, 15, maybe 15 to 16% because the power plant will also add up. So that is what I feel we should be doing. And it should gradually improve. I mean, in second quarter, I don't expect it to improve much, but from third quarter, I expect it to increase more.
Okay. Great, sir. Thanks. Thanks for the opportunity and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Maulik Patel from Equirus Securities. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity and congratulations on good set of numbers, sir. So a few questions. One is, any further clarity we have on the recycled project which you have been following up?
Yeah, recycle project, we have done trials in a very small manner, which was like 50 kgs per day. And now we are going on the second stage. We are building a small plant where we'll be able to do almost 1,000 kgs per day. And 1,000 per kgs per day, we can do some seed marketing also with that. So once that is successful, then we will go for the final big plant. So this will take another at least 6 to 7 months. 5-6 months to establish and then to work around the parameters for another 1 or 2 months. So by once we are successful in that, then we will go for the bigger plant, which would take at least 1 year after that.
Okay. And second question is on competitive intensity side. I mean, there was in the Vilosa plant which was fired, and I think there is a capacity addition was also announced by Indorama also a couple of months back. So are we still looking at another deficit market for the polyester yarn for the next 1.5 years? Still, is that same situation is still there?
Yeah, I think the polyester market will remain deficit for a long time to come, because the internationally in the normal times, the demand is increasing by almost 2.5 to 3 million tons. And so though that demand, once the COVID is over, I think will come back. Also, according to me, the population increase is happening worldwide. So that demand will also come in one go, and there has been no increase in the supply from last 1.5 to 2 years. So all these things will, I think, will have a good period once the COVID is over worldwide, and there will be good demand.
Mm-hmm. And is there any update on the PLI scheme where you mentioned that the man-made fibers were the part of the...
Tumhi kya vyakti shi bolat ahat, tyane tumcha call na hold...
Yeah. See, there has been no updates from the ministry, but whatever we have been hearing, and there has been some agencies who have been talking and taking the views. So whatever we have gathered from that, based on that, I have said that they are bringing PLI scheme for mainly MMF-based garments and fabrics, and also some technical textiles. Technical textiles are basically also made from man-made.
Sure. And so the last question is on a domestic demand. I think there was definitely hit in month of April, May because of the second wave. Have you seen on a similar uptrend what has happened the last time, when the last time in the previous year, the post first COVID wave, there was a tremendous demand, which is pent up demand, which has come up from the hinterland, rural and other areas.
But are you looking? Yeah, you see, last time also the main demand started coming from end of August only. Till mid-August, there was not much demand. The demand immediately picked up end of August only. So I expect the same to happen. But this time what has happened is the pipeline were not so dry, because people were producing and holding the stocks.
Sure.
So I think by August end, then we should see, because there will be marriage seasons also starting, and also the festival season starting. And I think this vaccination drive would also have picked up quite a bit by now then. So all these factors will see that there is a good demand for textiles after August end.
Great, sir. Thank you, and wish you all the best.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Neeraj Manchanka from White Pine Investment. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity, and congrats on maintaining reasonable numbers on the in the reduced environment. I wanted to know on the CAPEX front, you had given the press release on increasing capacity. Can you give more color on how and timelines on when it will scale up, and how much capacity addition it will add on a yearly numbers, on yearly volume?
See, right now we have just planned for one CAPEX, which is expansion of POY capacity and some debottlenecking in polymer. So that will be completed by first quarter of next year. And okay, so we'll have 9 years of production, 9 months of production in next quarter, next financial year from that. And also we are planning to put up more texturizing unit, but that we are planning to put in the subsidiary of Latex, because there are a lot of benefits which will be available to a new company, as textile is a part, texturizing we get tough also from the center, and also there are certain benefits from the state, like interest subsidy and also power subsidy of 2 rupees per unit is available. So we will be doing it in a different company, but 100% subsidy of that. But that yet to be finalized. I think maybe after the second quarter, we'll take a decision on that. And the second, we are doing a small expansion, or you can say in R&D, of putting up that 1,000 kgs per day of waste recycling. So that will be operational by end of this financial year only.
Okay. These are the only available. And then next year, once that recycling, waste recycling is through, then we will invest in putting up a plant for the waste recycling in a bigger way of 100 tons per day.
Got it. And what would be the gross margins of the DTY and FDY for the quarter?
It's very difficult to say for the quarter, but as I have indicated, we should be doing around 14 rupees per kg on our total production as a year as a whole, 13, 14 rupees.
Okay. And there is some restatement in the capacities that you have put in the presentation. Any
minor changes we have done because of the denier changes. It means in the same machinery, if you change from one denier to another, the capacity changes. So based on the last 1 year experience, we have done minor changes. You will see the total, there is a reduction of only 1760 tons out of 383 tons. Rest is just shifting from one to the other.
Okay. So any specific color on how it would have some changes for your output as a whole, like in terms of margins or the mix would change or any color on that?
So margins will remain quite healthy, I think, once demand picks up.
Okay.
Main products is FDY and DTY and POI. So chips, we don't have much margin. So that's why we are trying to convert maximum possible chips to yarn. So that's why putting more capacity of POI and DTY in next 1 year.
Okay. And last, how is the margin trended over the quarter and the current run rates of margin? Just a color on that rather than a number. Like
margins after Q4 had been going down since the COVID restrictions were applied and the demand and the markets were closed. But now as the things are opening up, the demand is picking up and the margins are also started inching up. But it will take some time for the demand to pick up. Like I said, maybe another month or so.
Okay, yes, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of BT Security from Manya Finance. Please go ahead.
Hello. Yeah, am I audible? Hello.
Yes, sir,
you are. Yeah, I just wanted to have an update on what is the situation of our shares which have been pledged and when are we planning to unpledge them?
See, the share pledge is not that we have borrowed money against that. At various time when we had borrowed money for the company from the banks, so this has been given as a collateral security. And now since the security with the banks is quite good, we have already applied for depledging them, and the it's in the advanced stage, and hopefully we will be able to get depledged by end of this quarter.
That's great.
So there is no actual borrowing on this. Like when you borrow term loans, so they ask for collateral security at various times, and that time they would say that, okay, why don't you give shares if you don't have any property to give. And we used to give them certain shares to get the loan.
It's basically for the loans for the company only, not for any personal.
No, there is no personal borrowing on this. These are all pledged with the banks of Philatex only, the commercial banks which have given loan to Philatex. There is not even 1 rupee borrowing of personal loan by pledging the shares.
Okay. And all the expansion which we are planning to do, about 130 crores, according to the latest announcement, is all by foreign currency loans only, or are we planning to even do a preferential to promoters?
Right now, we will be taking some ECB, which is the machine which we are importing from Germany. So there we can get a ECB at a very lower rate of interest. Rest will be all through internal accruals.
Okay. So how much is the loan? If
loan would be around 52 crores.
52 crores. Okay.
Yeah.
So rest
all will be internal accruals.
Okay, that's great. Thank you.
And whatever extra cash flows we have, then we will retire rupee loans in advance in this year also, like we did last year.
Okay, so by this year, what is the target?
Our target is to achieve at least on term loans to equity around 0.5.
Right.
Okay. Right,
this
now we are.
This will include the 52 crores we are taking from.
Yeah, it will include that. Including that, by end of the year, we should be targeting to go to 0.5.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jeet Chokalingam from Equinox. Please go ahead. Mr. Jeet, please go ahead with the question. Your line is unmuted. Jeet, may we request you to please unmute yourself if muted from your handset. As there is no response from the line, we will move to the next question, which is from the line of Darshit Shah from Motilal Oswal. Please go ahead. Mr. Darshit Shah, please go ahead with the question.
My question has been answered. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Participants, you may please press star and one to ask a question now. The next question is from the line of MS Rajasekhar, from an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. My question is this. You are doing the chemical processing of the recycled yarn, recycled waste. Will you be the first one in the country or the world to do this kind of chemical processing?
No, we will not be the first one. I think there is one company which was named Polygenta. Now their name's been changed.
Okay.
So they are doing it, but their process is different, and they use only transparent and very white bottles only. We'll be able to use any colored bottle also, and we'll be able to use yarn waste, and as well as we are working to use fabric waste also. So it will be different than them.
Okay. And what is the demand for this recycled yarn? Is there a regulation to use this recycled yarn all over the world?
No, there is no regulation, but a lot of brands have taken a pledge to use the recycled yarn. And they have taken a pledge, I think, before COVID that by 2025, they will be using 100% recycled yarn for their products.
Okay.
To name a few, like Uniqlo, H&M, Zara,
okay.
and a lot others. So they are ready to pay a good premium for the fabric made out of this.
Mm-hmm.
And the availability is quite poor. So right now, it is commanding a good premium in the market.
Oh, okay.
In the way we are producing, our cost of production will not be higher than the cost what we are doing to produce the virgin yarn. So it will be similar or lower than that. So there is no risk. So whatever extra premium we get, that will be additional margin over and above the virgin margins.
That's right. But looks like the way you are now you are putting up 1,000 kg plants per day plant.
Yeah.
By the time you come up with your production, it should be 2024, I think. With your full in case you are successful.
Yeah, it will be beginning of 24. Yeah, right. Yeah.
24, no? So after that, that's right.
So this is
right.
21, no? 23, sorry.
23.
Yeah, somewhere in first half of 23, we should have the plant running.
You should have the plant, full-fledged plant running.
Yeah, full-fledged. This plant will be running in the next year only, the first last quarter of this financial year. And once we are able to establish that, then it will take another 12 months, so which will be end of FY23.
But yeah, my question is, are you satisfied and successful with this small plant of 100 kg per day on that?
We are quite optimistic. We have done a lot of trials outside also, and we are optimistic. That's why we are investing more money in going in the 1,000 kg. So because whatever shortcomings are there, it's easier for us to correct in the 1,000 kg plant. There are a lot of things which we are not able to do in the 50 kg. So we have to go for a little higher capacity. So there we can do some modifications and bring it to a level where we can take a plunge for the 100 tons per day plant.
Okay, okay, right, sir. Right, sir. Are
we are taking somebody... help of a lot of experts in the industry. We have hired one or two consultants who are helping us to do all this.
You feel, Finetex feels that this is a good area, that's why you are investing and then all your energy.
Yeah, yeah. I think R&D is a good area. We are also investing in developing different kind of yarns also. Because of COVID, we've not been able to launch them properly, but we have made a lot of different varieties of polyester yarn, which will give different feel in the fabrics. So once this COVID is over, we'll be able to do that. You can see on the website, we have developed a lot of different specialty yarns also.
Okay, okay, sir. One small question is, what is your total debt now as of date?
As a debt, term loans is around 530 crores.
So that should come down by about 100-150 crores by this year.
It will come down by 100-150 crores, and there'll be addition of net. It will be coming down by at least 100 crores.
Okay, right, sir. One small question is, are you increasing your promoter shareholding in the company?
No, we are not increasing anything as of now.
Is it anything as of now? Thank you so much. Thanks for your listening. All the best, sir. Please. Looking forward for this recycled yarn project.
Sure.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, please press star and one. As there are no further questions from the participants, I would now like to hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Yeah, I'd like to thank all the participants for sparing their time and joining us, and hope to see you again in our next conference call of Q2 FY22. Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you. On behalf of Motilal Oswal Financial Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.